President John F. Kennedy.
Ladies and gentlemen, the very word secrecy is repugnant in a free and open society. And we are, as a people, inherently and historically opposed to secret societies, to secret oaths, and to secret proceedings. We decided long ago that the dangers of excessive and unwarranted concealment of pertinent facts far outweighed the dangers which are cited to justify it. Even today, there is little value in opposing the threat of a closed society by imitating its arbitrary restrictions. Even today, there is little value in ensuring the survival of our nation if our traditions do not survive with it. And there is very grave danger that an announced need for increased security will be seized upon by those anxious to expand its meaning to the very limits of official censorship and concealment. That I do not intend to permit to the extent that it's in my control. And no official of my administration, whether his rank is high or low, civilian or military, should interpret my words here tonight as an excuse to censor the news, to stifle dissent, to cover up our mistakes, or to withhold from the press and the public the facts they deserve to know. For we are opposed around the world by a monolithic and ruthless conspiracy that relies primarily on covert means for expanding its sphere of influence, on infiltration instead of invasion, on subversion instead of elections, on intimidation instead of free choice, on guerrillas by night instead of armies by day. It is a system which has conscripted vast human and material resources into the building of a tightly knit, highly efficient machine that combines military, diplomatic, intelligence, economic, scientific, and political operations. Its preparations are concealed, not published. Its mistakes are buried, not headlined. Its dissenters are silenced, not praised.
Praised. No expenditure is questioned, no rumor is printed, no secret is revealed. No president should fear public scrutiny of his program, for from that scrutiny comes understanding, and from that understanding comes support or opposition, and both are necessary. I am not asking your newspapers to support an administration, but I am asking your help in the tremendous task of informing and alerting the American people. For I have complete confidence. In the response and dedication of our citizens, whenever they are fully informed. I not only could not stifle controversy among your readers, I welcome it. This administration intends to be candid about its errors. For as a wise man once said, an error doesn't become a mistake until you refuse to correct it. We intend to accept full responsibility for our errors, and we expect you to point them out when we miss them. Without debate, without criticism, no administration and no country can succeed, and no republic can survive. That is why the Athenian lawmaker Solon decreed it a crime for any citizen to shrink from controversy. And that is why our press was protected by the First Amendment, the only business in America specifically protected by the Constitution, not primarily to amuse and entertain, not to emphasize the trivial and the sentimental, not to simply give the public what it wants, but to inform, to arouse, to reflect, to state our dangers and our opportunities, to indicate our crises and our choices, to lead, mold, educate, and sometimes even anger public opinion. This means greater coverage and analysis of international news. For it is no longer far away and foreign, but close at hand and local. It means greater attention to improved understanding of the news, as well as improved transmission. And it means, finally, that government at all levels must meet its obligation to provide you with the fullest possible information outside the narrowest limits of national security. And so it is to the printing press, to the recorder of man's deeds, the keeper of his conscience, the courier of his news, that we look for strength and assistance, confident that with your help, man will be what he was born to be, free and independent.
You were both in Skull and Bones, the secret society.
It's so secret we can't talk about it.
What does that mean for America? The conspiracy theorists are going to go
wild. I'm sure they are. I don't know. I haven't seen the web.
Number 322?
You both were members of Skull and Bones, a secret society at Yale. What does that tell us?
Not much, because it's a secret.
Is there a secret handshake? Is there a secret code?
I wish there were something secret I could manifest.
322, a secret number?
There are all kinds of secrets, Tim, but one thing is not a secret. I disagree with this president's direction that he's taking the country. We can do a better job, and I intend to do it.
And we'll be watching. Be safe on the campaign trail. John Kerry, thanks for joining us. And we'll be right back.
It's good to be back at the Council on Foreign Relations. As Pete mentioned, I've been a member for a long time and was actually a director for some period of time. I never mentioned that when I was campaigning for re-election back home in Wyoming.
Senator, how you doing?
I'm good. How are you
doing? Can I ask you a quick question while you sign that?
Sure.
It was reported in June of 2006, you attended a meeting in Ottawa, Canada, the Bilderberg Group. Can you comment on that? What's going on for the Bilderberg meeting, and what do you guys talk about up there?
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Yeah, you do. I was reported you were up there, and people saw you up there. I just want to know what you guys talk about and meet about up there.
Sir, I don't know.
Why are they such top secret meetings?
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Your husband went to a Bilderberg meeting, too. I'm just wondering. I'm not being rude or anything.
No, I just
want to know what happens at these meetings.
Well, since I wasn't there, I have no idea.
Okay, thank you, Senator.
Thank you. How are you? There you go.
Thank you.
Listen, I am... a happy member of the Bohemian Grove. I like the folks who come there, and it's really inappropriate for me to talk about the group beyond that. Thank you.
Have you been there for the ceremony with the cremation of care?
Frankly, I don't think that's something I need to talk to you about.
Have you been there for the ceremony with the cremation of care?
I don't think that's something I need to talk to you about.
Really?
That's right.
Well, I'm Alex Jones, and I snuck in there in 2000. I'm the guy that blew it wide open
and got the video. It's been on national TV.
Well, I disrespect you for that.
You do?
I do.
But it's a lot of big public officials going in there. Don't we deserve to know?
You took it. I don't know anything about you, and I don't know anything about your film. But if you go in there with an understanding, you violated that understanding by releasing that film, and I don't respect you for that.
Really? But you, we have public
you, I'm sorry, public. You took an understanding when you went in there that you would not do that film. And you did you have an understanding when you went in there?
No.
Did you crash it?
Yes.
Yeah, and it has no trespassing signs there, too, doesn't it?
No, they put them
yes,
up after.
Oh, I'm
I
sorry.
Just walked in.
I'm sorry, sir. I've been there before. I know what the circumstances are, and I'm sorry you violated the understandings. But it was not, that was not a gentlemanly thing to do.
But what about the ritual? Is the ritual gentlemanly?
Sir, everything. I don't owe you this comment.
I know.
You have. This is what's called ambush journalism, and I disrespect you for that as well. So thank you,
ever
and goodbye.
Been in the ritual?
That's none of your damn business.
Oh.
I've spoken